You're all welcome to church this morning. This morning we'll be wrapping up the message that we started last week titled Joseph the Blessed in the Pit, in Slavery, in the Prison, and in the Palace. Joseph the Blessed in the Pit, in Slavery, in the Prison, and in the Palace. Let's say it together. Joseph the Blessed. In the pit, in slavery, in the prison, and in the palace. Hallelujah. And last week we understood that the blessing of God was upon Joseph. And that blessing moved him from the 11th position in his family to the first position. When the blessing of God is upon your life, it does not matter where men put you. The blessing will relocate you to where God wants you to be. Amen. That is somebody's story here. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Now, we also understood last week that as a result of the envy from his brothers, they initially planned to kill him and throw him into the pit. But the mercy of God located him, and the worst they could do was throw him in the pit. Now, listen, when the blessing of God is upon your life, no man can stop the will of God for your life except you. You are the only one who can limit what God wants to do in your life. But this morning, you will hear a word that will help you materialize every blessing that the Lord has for you in the name of Jesus. Today, we're going to be continuing. We're going to be looking at Joseph the Blessed in slavery, in Potiphar's house, in the prison, and the palace. Now, please understand clearly, this message is loaded. It's a little bit long, but as much as possible, I'm going to try to compress it and run a little bit faster. But please let your spirit be open, because there's something that God wants to deposit in you in the name of Jesus. Now, a truth to establish about the phases of the trials that Joseph went through is to understand that God is faithful and he will always come to the rescue of the righteous. Joseph went through several phases. As a matter of fact, almost four or five phases of his life over a 13-year period was the period that God was using to prepare him for the ultimate position that he was preparing him for. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 13 says, "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above what you are able, but with the temptation, always also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it." In other words, God knows the capacity of your resistance. God knows how far you can hold on. God knows it. So he gauges it and brings the trial that is at your level. There is no trial that is above you. Listen to me clearly. No trial comes your way that is beyond what you can bear. Whatever trial faces you is because God has given you the capacity to take it. And that was the story of Joseph. Psalm 34 verse 19, the Bible says, "Many, many, many." Let's read it together. "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all." So God is faithful. So no matter the trial you are going through now, there is a way of escape. God is coming for you. I thought I was praying for someone here. In the name of Jesus. That's one truth to establish. The second truth is, brethren, every phase of the trials that Joseph went through taught him a vital lesson that was needed for his predestined office. And we shall examine each of these phases. Every phase, there was something that was deposited in him that was going to be needed in the throne. Listen, what you are going through now is depositing a virtue in you that you will need a few years from now. Whatever you are going through now, God is depositing some virtues in you. He's trying to bring up something in you that will be needed for your ultimate office. So if somebody is going to rise to the highest, you can expect him to go to the deepest level of tests and trials to cook him and get him set and prepare him for the extent of the job that is ahead of him. Praise the Lord. Now, let us look at Joseph the blessed in the pit. We looked at it a little bit last week. But what did Joseph learn in the pit? Let's understand. In Genesis 37, 22, the Bible says, "And Reuben said to them, shed no blood, but cast him into the pit that is in the wilderness." Underline the word. The pit, first, is a pit, and secondly, is in the wilderness. Verse 24, he said, "And they took him and cast him into a pit, and the pit was empty. There was no water in it." So it was a pit first. Secondly, it was in the wilderness. How many of us love wilderness? Would like to live in the wilderness someday? Okay, I didn't see any hands up. Praise God. Now, it was a pit in the wilderness. It was an empty pit where there is no water. What were the things that Joseph learned? Two things. Number one, a pit in the wilderness is one of the most quiet places on the earth. Would you agree with me? It's a pit down in the earth, and then it's in the wilderness. The wilderness usually has no life. It was a pit. It was in the wilderness. So one of the lessons that God taught Joseph while he was in that pit was quietness and meditation. Quietness and meditation. And like we said last week, he missed Mama 101. Mama 101 would say, "Shh, stop talking. Be quiet, be quiet." But his mother had died, so he missed that lesson. But in the pit where there was quietness, where there was deadness, where nothing was happened, God taught him to be quiet and watch. And God taught him, you know, meditation comes when you are quiet and silent and you can hear the voice of the Lord speaking in the spirit. That was one lesson, vital lesson that God taught Joseph in the process, in the pit. What was the second lesson? The Bible says that the pit had no water. So he was thirsty. And you remember, the moment his brothers threw him in the pit, they went to eat and drink. But he was there, no water, thirsty, hungry, I imagine. What does that tell us? Every true leader, every leader that is going to be successful, you must have a time when you separate yourself from food and drink. A time to fast and pray. That was a vital lesson that God was teaching Joseph in the pit. Praise the Lord. Now, let us move on. Like I said, I'm going to try to rush. It's a little bit long. Joseph the blessed in slavery. After his brothers, after the lesson that he was supposed to learn in the pit was complete, his brothers thought, "Let us bring him out." And they were walking on their own path, but God, the ultimate masterminder, was doing something in his life. That phase of his life was over, never to go back to it. And God said, "Now it's time to learn the next lesson that you are going to need on the throne." What lessons did he learn in the slavery? His brothers came together and said, "Let us sell this boy for 20 pieces of silver." Genesis 37, verse 20 and verse 28. He said, "Come now, therefore, let us slay him, cast him into some pit, and we will say, some evil beast had devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." So their motivation for throwing him into the pit in the first place was because he was a dreamer. Because the hand of God, they could see the hand of God upon him. See, when men see the hand of God upon your life, they try to manipulate things. This thing must not come to pass. But if it's the Almighty God whose hand is upon your life, there is no man who can stop you. No man can delay you. They can only try to extend that period in your life. But you see, when the hand of the Almighty God is upon you, no man can stop you. They cast him into the pit because of his dreams. That was their motivation. But let us see, what were the two lessons he learned in slavery? Now, he was sold for 20 pieces of silver. And Bible scholars said it's an equivalent of $12.80. A whole human being for $12.80. Praise God. So that is to tell us it is not even about the money, because their father was a rich man. It was not about the money. But you see, one of the things that God was trying to show him, they may be your brothers. Never you put your trust and confidence in man. Never you. Look at your brothers negotiating. Okay, give us $1 more. Instead of 19 pieces of silver, okay, make it $20. Right before him, his brothers were negotiating to sell him into slavery. Wow. That is to tell him, listen, brethren, and I'm telling you today, if your trust and confidence is in man, please remove it now. It is time to put your trust and your confidence in the living God than man. That was one vital lesson. Never you put your trust in any man, Joseph. Because right before his eyes, his brothers were negotiating. Okay, add $1 more. Add $1 more. Okay, now you can take him. Right before him, they betrayed him. That's betrayal. They sold him off to slavery and said, now you can go. And they closed their eyes. So that was one vital lesson that God taught him. Another thing that God taught him in slavery was, you must understand, the motivation behind every crime that people commit. When people commit crime, say they kill somebody, or they betray someone, or they do a thing, there are three major reasons behind it. One of it is envy, the other is selfishness, and the third one is pride. These were the things that God showed is him. Open your eyes to see what your brothers, the one you call your blood brothers, what they are saying and doing about your life. Understand the motivation behind them. Don't always take everything on the face value. When a man talks to you, oh no, we are with you, we are your friends, don't worry, they laugh at you. Don't always take things at the face value. Understand in the spirit the motivation behind everything that they do. And right before his eyes, those things were playing out. He could see my brothers selling me, oh my God, to Midianites, people you don't know, and you are confident giving me away to these people. You can now put yourself in that position and see how you feel. That was another vital lesson that God taught Joseph in slavery. Praise the Lord. And he was going to need that. I will show it to us when he got to the throne. How did these things play out and how did they help him? Praise the Lord. Now, Joseph the blessed in Potiphar's house. Now, you're saying Joseph the blessed. I purposely called it Joseph the blessed in the pit. That's not a good thing. It sounds contradictory. Joseph the blessed in slavery sounds contradictory. Joseph the blessed as a slave in Potiphar's house sounds contradictory. Listen, all that was happening was the blessing of God was upon his head while he was going through all this negative situation. The blessing could not be wiped off. The blessing could not be destroyed. The blessing could not be cast off. No matter what you go through, when the blessing of God is upon your life, it cannot be washed away. It cannot be removed. No circumstance is capable of removing the blessing of God upon your life, because blessings come from God, not from man. It was only yesterday I was telling my wife, I said, if men were God, if men were God, but thank God, God is God. Hallelujah. Lift up your hands and worship this living God. Hallelujah. Okay, let's go on. Joseph the blessed in Potiphar's house as a slave. If you get home, please read Genesis chapter 39, verses 1 to 8. But I'll try and paraphrase some of the things that happened. In verse 1, the Bible tells us he was sold as a slave to the chief security officer of Pharaoh. Not just anybody. He could have been bought by one of the officers, but the chief security officer of Pharaoh. What do we see from that? Now, his assignment, ultimate assignment, was going to be with Pharaoh. But God brought him a little closer and was trying to arrange his way into the house of Pharaoh. Listen, what you are going through now is bringing you a step closer to the ultimate for your life. So don't resist it. Don't reject it. Say, Lord, give me grace and strengthen me to go through this. That is one thing that we saw. Every step that he took was moving him closer to the ultimate of God for his life. In verse 2 of Genesis 39, the Bible says, God was with him. He was a prosperous man. in the house of this master, God was with him. In other words, the blessing was with him. God was with him. No matter what he was going through, God was with him. But I was wondering, prosperous man, at this time he didn't own anything. How could he be prosperous? But so that made me went to look a little further into scripture. I dug deep into the Hebrew word for the word prosperous. And I found that the word prosperous in Hebrew means salak, T-S-A-L-A-C-H, which means to break out. Listen carefully. To come mightily, to go over, be good, be meet, be profitable. In summary, an overflow of a good attitude. That was what the word prosperous meant. Now, what is this for us? This is a must for everyone who will be successful. You need to depend on an inner strength of peace, of love, of joy. What will make you will not come from outside. What will take you to where God desires from you will not come from anybody else. It will not come from the things that you have around you. It will not come from your spouse. It will not come from your friends. It will not come from anybody, but it's inside of you. Joseph was a prosperous man. In other words, inside of Joseph, there was a good attitude. Inside of Joseph was godliness. Inside of Joseph was love, was peace, was joy. He was a prosperous man. In other words, enough. He had enough on the inside of him to keep him going. He never needed an encouragement. There are so many people, when an issue happened to them, you will need almost the whole world to talk to them before they feel better. Enough of that. Let your inner strength come from inside of you. Let the motivation come from the inside of you. God has deposited more than enough to make you joyful. Stop carrying the world on your head. God does not owe you anything. No man owes you anything. Stop draining the strength of the brethren. Are you the only one? You are the one they will come and visit in the morning, in the afternoon, in the night. Enough of that. Take up yourself. Tell yourself, I want to succeed. I am moving forward. Everything that I need is in the inside of me. Your prosperity comes first from the inside, not from the outside. This week I had one powerful man of God say something. He said, look, the richest nations in the world are not the one that has the richest of resources. No. The poorest nations in the world are not the ones that have the poorest of resources. As a matter of fact, it is the opposite. Check Africa. The poorest people live in Africa. But Africa is laden with gold. Africa is laden with oil. Africa is laden with uranium. Africa has all the resources. Some of it which you don't find in any other part of the world is in Africa. But the people of Africa are the poorest. Why? What prospers a man does not come from the environment. It comes from inside. That is why the Bible says, I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health, even as your soul. Is your soul outside? Is your soul in my hand? Where is your soul? Even as your soul prospers. So what will prosper you is not from the outside. It's from here. If you can see it, if you can touch it in the spirit, if you can perceive it in the spirit, you got it already. That was the case of Joseph. He had nothing in the physical to his account. He had no bank account. He was still a slave in Potiphar's house. But the Bible calls him a prosperous man. Why? Because he is so loaded with everything on the inside of him. Listen, your success in life is not dependent on anything from the outside. It's from the inside. Let someone lift up their hand and say, I believe. I believe. And I receive it. My prosperity starts now. If you can see yourself prosperous, nobody can make you poor. Nobody can make you poor. So with this positive mental attitude that Joseph had, everything around him turned. Everything around Joseph turned. Look at verse 2. The Bible says, and the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. And he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him. And the Lord made all things to prosper in his hand. All things. So, if you will be prosperous, it starts here. The poorest people in the world are poor here first, before they are poor outside. The richest people in the world are rich here first, before they are rich on the outside. I see God lifting you up. I see his hand come upon you in the name of Jesus Christ. What else did Joseph learn in Potiphar's house? Everything was going well until his next lesson was due, and he had to be tempted into adultery by Potiphar's wife. Did you notice that Potiphar's wife had no name? In other words, people with low morals have no relevance in this world. So the first thing any child of God would do, wash off yourself from all impurities. Stand on a solid ground. When you are righteous, it puts you on a pedestal that no man can stop. No devil can stop, because he will never have anything against you. But when you are in when your foundation, the Bible says, if the foundation be destroyed, what will the righteous do? So please wake up. Tell your neighbor, wake up. The Bible speaking in 1 John chapter 2, it says, love not the world, neither the things of the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And verse 17, the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God will abide forever. Do you want to abide forever? Then begin to do the will of God. Begin to do the will of God. Now, what happened when Potiphar's wife tempted Joseph? The Bible says Joseph resisted. Resisted every overtures of Potiphar's wife and had to flee. Your ability to push back teaches resilience and persistence. Sometimes, some of the things God allows you to do is you are pushing back. You are resisting. What that is teaching you is teaching you how to be strong and how to be resilient. In other words, you are solid. No breakup. The Bible says, when the edge is broken, the serpent bites it. Your edge is secured. It's no breakage. No leakage. No leakage. No time for the devil. No nonsense. That's what God taught Joseph at that time. He was pushing back. He was saying, Madam, no. Madam, no. If Joseph had given in to the pressure from Potiphar's wife, he would have ended up the chief slave in the house of Potiphar. Now you must understand, this one will shock you, brethren. And it's something that is real every day. Let me tell you, it is not all open doors that are opportunities. Some of them are traps. In the place where we came from back in Africa, the kind of traps, because when I was a little boy, I used to set traps for these little rodents. You will put something inside the cage and open the mouth like this. Is that an opportunity? So listen, there are so many doors that look like open, but you need to ask, Lord, is this my opportunity? You need to be able to ask. The Bible speaking in John chapter 6 verse 15, it happened to Jesus. When Jesus therefore perceived that they will come and take him by force to make him a king, he departed again into a mountain and by himself. Jesus saw that people were enjoying the miracle. Wow, bread today, meat tomorrow, fish tomorrow, and everything was going great. And they said, this man, if we make him our king, Every day we will eat fish. Every day we will eat burger. Every day we will have wonderful meat. So they arranged to go and capture Jesus and then make him the king. Because if we make him the king, this town, I can tell you, we're going to have fun. But he understood that was not his calling. It is not everything that you are called to do, brethren. Somebody says, oh, there's an opportunity to make a business. Oh, wow, wonderful. Ask the Lord. Lord, is this my chance? Is this my opportunity? And until you do that, you keep entering into trap. Some of those traps, they trap down destinies and keep them down forever. However, I found something interesting. This will interest you. Now, in Genesis 39, 11, and 14, please listen carefully. On the fateful day, on the day when Potiphar's wife was going to strip herself naked and stand before Joseph, see what the Bible says happened that day. Verse 11, and it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house there within. None of the men. Nobody. It was quiet. It was only Madam Potiphar alone. Nobody else was in the house. So he could have easily hidden his iniquity. Listen, the traps that trap most believers, pastors, members, everyone, the trap that trap most believers is when there is nobody around. You are alone. You travel to a city in a hotel. You are there alone. Nobody is looking at you. What are you doing at those times? There is a trap there. There is a trap. Don't think that whatever you do there will hide, will be hidden. No. Let me show us. In verse 14, after she had said, I'm sure, she probably tell all the men, nobody should come here at all. All of you, come quiet. Go everywhere. And she stripped herself naked and said, Joseph, come. Joseph immediately sensed it. This is not a chance. He left his garment. He took off. But look at what happened in verse 14. Verse 14 says, that she called unto the men of her house and spake unto them, saying, see, he had brought to us an Hebrew to mock us. Where did the men come from? I thought the Bible said they were not there. All of a sudden, the men showed up. Listen, sin is deceptive. Sin deceives. It will make it appear as if nothing will come out of it. Just do it. But after it's done, it opens up. After Adam and Eve ate the apple, the Bible says their eyes opened. They saw, oh my God, we misbehaved already. Sin has no hiding place. Sin is a sinker. Nobody was there. But all of a sudden, after Joseph fled, she called to the men of the house. They showed up. What does that tell us? Sin is deceptive. Never be slayed by the power of sin. That was one vital lesson that we saw in that place. And finally, we saw Mrs. Potiphar lied against him, put him in jail. But there's another vital lesson that he learned in the jail. Time will not allow me to go beyond this now. There's a book that the Lord is placing on my heart to write. Very shortly, we're going to see it. And then we'll be able to complete all of this. Shall we rise up this hour? Let's lift up our hands. There's still so much more to learn. But for time's sake, we will need to wrap up now. Eventually, brethren, you understand the end of this, the end result. Joseph became the prime minister in Egypt. All of those vital lessons he learned in the pit, the one he learned in slavery, the one he learned in Potiphar's house, they all came to play. And as Egypt became the number one nation in the world in the time of famine. And the man that will rule the world had to go through some trials. His trials lasted 13 years. 13 years. You will agree with me that it was worth it. Joseph thereafter lived for 80 more years after he became the prime minister. So 13 years of hardship, of learning some things for 80 years of gain. What you are going through now is the gateway to the great future. You say, oh, this challenge is too much. It's beyond me. It is because of the height of the place that God is taking you to.